there was my an exhibition from the New York Museum of Modern Art here in the plaza in front of the school, and the students has made two structures, one of the balcony and the other one in the courtyard between the trees, a wonderful structure, beautiful, a piece of art. And so it's for me a great pleasure to be once more here at this special school, because it's a special school which we have no similarity in the world. And so I have to find my way. Of course, I have some pictures brought with me. It's the only way, talking without manuscript, and to try to show you a little bit about my work, from our work, because working in architecture is not like in other arts, literature or painting or sculptures. You always have to work with teams. It's a teamwork, and so many people are always related to one of these teams. I'm not an engineer, and as architect, I'm more an autodidact, because I started without being a trained architect. It was 1946 in prison of worship in France, in a beautiful city named Chartres with a large and great church. I had worked and studied before stonemasonry. My father was a sculptor and a stonemason, and my grandfather too. So I'm coming to this part of architecture as a sculptor. And I see all building also as a three-dimensional sculptor. But I worked also in engineering, not in engineering. I was happy to help engineers to do their job, because the architecture is a part of art and engineering is a part of sciences. And they both have to work together in a very good way. And sometimes they need translators, interpreters. And I was happy sometimes to work in the middle between these two professions, because they are completely overlapping, coming and working together for one goal, one more for natural sciences and the other one for human being and art. And this is a big problem in architecture, that these two professions very seldom are coming really together. Of course, I have had good friends helping me. The oldest one was Fritz Leonhardt. He's not more among us. He was a tower builder or bridge builder. Then Ulf Arup, then Ted Heppert. And in architecture, many others like Rolf Gutbrod, and also from this town like Richard Burton and so on. So I could work together very happy. So it's not, I cannot say that all of this work which I'm showing now, it is just my work. But let's start and going through. And if you have any question, please ask. I don't like to make written academic lectures. Just I will talk. Could I have the first two pictures? They are just a sculptural work of the early and middle of the 50s, just to show another way in going on. next picture. And I start with a stone masonry because I'm going from the heavy to the light. And at the end of my lecture, I show newest projects which we are just doing now. On the left side, it is a mosque which we built with Rolf Gutbrod and of Arab and partners when it was on the leadership of Ted Heppold in Mecca. And on the right side, it was also a stony building. There was Nabil Fanous on, I think he lives in London. And for the new diplomatic club, which is called now Tuvek Palace, a stony building. Next picture. Also from the same building, working with stone from Saudi Arabia. Next picture. But this building is then in Riyadh. The first one was in Mecca. Next picture. Now, glass is similar like stone, but more brittle as natural stone. And I was very happy when Richard Burton asked me to make a proposal for the church in Bristol, the old city church. And Ted and myself proposed a complete done roof out of glass, a so-called 100% glass building. We wanted to divide the old ruin so that the old ruin is really seen as ruin and not changed by the new roof. And the chorus is made out of painted glass without steel. So this glass type, but it's very difficult really to work with structural glass. It was about, I think 12 years ago or 15 years. Next picture. I come to some steel buildings. I developed in the 60s with my, around 1960 with my class. I was a professor in this time in the States with a class at Yale University, the so-called tree structures. Not to imitate trees, because trees are structures in bending, but structures which are in compression, which have a kind of self-shaping, they are shaping himself. So the model of the left side was done as a hanging structure. On the right side is for a church in Berlin, and where the girders are out of a thin steel members and a cable underneath. Next picture, built 1962, so in the same, nearly the same year. And this church tower was done completely it's standing in Berlin, in the south of the city, and was completely prefabricated, and we have drawn it through the whole city overnight, and the next morning we erected it in 2 hours. On the right side also, so-called tree structures, it was for our design in the late 70s for the so-called COCOMAS project, the King's Office of Saudi Arabia, also in the office included were the government and the new parliament of Saudi Arabia. We started to build it, but then King Khaled died, so it never happened. to build this type of structure. But I think it's a very often imitated structure now in the world, even in this country. And the engineers had to be the joint venture between of Arup and Bureau Heppold, because it was just those years when they both did divide. Next picture. And we have had around 1989 and 1990 a job for the German government to design a new road for the magnetic elevated railway, the German one, which should be ecological and aesthetically better. Of course, it wasn't built. Still, the government is making a big beam structure for the magnetic railway. And of course, it's a problem because 70 to 80% of the building costs are not the movement part, but the stable part. The rails are the expensive thing because they have to be very exact. And this work was also done with Ted himself was very engaged for this structure. Even we have had to develop new noses for these very high speed trains, which you see on the left side. Next picture. We are still on thin steel structure, and also this one, it is a monument for a German poet which lives in our countryside, lived in last century in our countryside village. It is a steel structure where little drops are coming out and falling in a fountain which is still on the same point where the old village fountain was. So the same structure is now used as a sculpture. Next picture. I'm coming now to another set of structures, because my concern also was that structure are leading to architectural forms. If you want to know what architectural forms are, it is very good to know structures and to develop structures and to know structures. And one of the oldest structures is, of course, in stone and now in concrete and other materials, is so-called shell structures, and especially shells without bending. Shells without bending can be very thin. They have no bending moment under their own weight. And so it's a reason that you can build them very thin, but they are the same shapes which you can do also in stone or in concrete without reinforcement. And so I made many studies with these types of shells. Next picture. I think one of the newest shells was built in this city, the courtyard of the British Museum. My wife and myself have been yesterday by chance in. It's a huge and large structure, and I give my congratulations to Bureau Heppold and especially also to Michael Dixon, which is here. Now, our second or third shell in this relation, the first one I built 1962, and this one we built, I think, 75 in Germany. the so-called multi-halle of Mannheim, pretty large, free spanning 80 meters. The biggest size of the lasses are more than 100 meters. Also a joint venture practically made from Ted and his colleagues, which are also here, out of wooden lattices of 2 by 2 inches, 47 to 47 millimeter, and it was possible to use them for this large spans, and the floor plan looks like an amoeba. It was a hall for the German Federal Garden show. It is still existing, and the hall is very stable, but it was covered with canvas, and it was really very, very cheap. 450 marks a square meter is a somewhat little more than $100 a square meter, and it is one of the cheapest buildings, long span buildings, which we did. Next picture. The erection is quite simple. The grid shell is connected on ground and then lifted with some very simple scaffold towers, which are lifted by a forklift. The simplest method of erection. And even we made a new experiment, and a part of the shell we did stand on cables. I think it was never done before to stand a shell like a man with two legs and outside to stand on cables, and you see the detail on the right side. I think this shell is now the mother of some 100 shells which are similar in the world, covered with canvas, covered with glass, or even with paper. Next picture. On the left side is a shell which friends did around Kikutake, did in Japan for the Nara Silk Road exhibition. On the right side, it was a design of myself for the World Exhibition in Sevilla, but it was only the second prize, so we haven't built it. Next picture. And this building looks very, very rough. And it was Ted and Richard Burton from ABQ, and we worked for Joan Makepeace at Hook Park, and west of London, and we used the trees which had to be cut out because the forest was too condensed and planted. And we made this room for the workshop spanning 15 or 17 meters and about 16 meters long, if I am right. Please correct me. And the trees are bended, but not cut by the saw. It's always very good if you are using round wood, not cut by the saw. It's only so difficult to use round wood. I have had a teacher, a famous German wooden engineer. He always asked his students, what is the biggest enemy of wood? And he wanted that the students answer the saw. Because with a saw you are destroying very often the power of the wood. Next picture. Grit structure, a combination of shell without bending and tree structures. It was once more for the project, the Kokoma's project, King's Office, Council of Ministers, and the Majlis al-Shura for Saudi Arabia in the late 70s. Thank you very much for showing always and making it possible that I can just say the next one. And now, once more, the next one, please. The latest shell where I had the possibility to help was done by Shigeru Ban. As I have heard, he has given a lecture at the school maybe last year. And he had the idea to make buildings out of paper, using old wasted paper, and had the idea to make the Japanese Pavilion at the World's Fair in Hanover last year out of tubes which are rolled of wasted paper, and after the World's Fair to dismantle the pavilion and make it once more to German wasted old paper. So he did. On the left side is a model. On the right side is a pavilion during erection. Next picture. And I tried to convince him always to make the skin of the pavilion out of paper. And it wasn't so easy as we thought. On the left side is this during erection. And on the right side is the inner part. But on the inner part, you really see the original paper. And to connect these tubes, we did not use a bolt like we have done it before. We have just bounded these tubes together. They are similar like a round wood. Next picture, please. And from and the shells without bending, I am going to buildings which are always without bending because they are shaping themselves that they are without bending, and so they can be very thin. One of the old or the oldest method to make these type of roofs are the Indonesian, Japanese, and Chinese pagoda roofs. When I was a student, I worked on these roofs. Later on, I was in Indonesia to study these old bamboo roofs, which are getting their form by themselves. And that's a reason that in these areas, bamboo roofs has been these shapes. But later on, especially in Japan, they are built from wood, and so you have to make them. But one little test building I could do also in this country, Hook Park, one of the master buildings for the wooden wood school from John Makepeace, always done together with Richard Burton. You see on the right side the erection of this building. They are very fresh, still wet, fresh, wet, and thin members of trunks out of the wood, which are bending themselves into this shape. Next picture. These, they are calling heavyweight, but they are not heavyweight. They are self-shaping, non-pre-stressed roof. A large one was started to build in the late 60s. It is our building together with Rolf Gutbrod and Ulf Arup and Partners under the leadership of Ted Heppold. And for the conference center in the city of Mecca. I was with Rolf Gutbrod responsible for this building. I have never seen it until now because I'm not a Muslim, so I'm not allowed to enter to see my building. But it's very nice. I think it's one of my best buildings because I have not seen it by myself. Because I'm always incredibly skeptical about these, what I am doing. But once more, these are hanging roofs without pre-stress. And in different shapes on the left side, it is for a so-called wooden grid to make shades, but the big lecture hall or conference hall, I think it was about 60 to 60 meters, are cables in one direction and the other when very thin rolled steel members and above wood, above heat insulation, and the outside is aluminum. From this building, I have shown on my second picture also the mosque. So we have built also a mosque for this building because it's in Mecca. Next picture. A similar structure for a chair factory in Germany called Wilkan, where thin lattices, only 6 to 9 centimeters, are taking the forces of this pavilion. Inside is a production site for chairs. Especially this client is very, very happy with this production pavilions because they are working in the pavilion in the so-called teamwork production. Next picture. On the left side, it was a design which we did also with a TED and for the Berlin Olympic Stadium, which was built in the early 30s. And they wanted to have a roof without touching the old building. So we made this type of roof on the left side, a free spanning, free hanging roof, not touching. We have been not happy to build it. Now it will get a new roof, but in a complete other way. Of course, you could always avoid to have a weight on this roof for getting the shape for this non-pre-stressed roof, but you can pre-stress structures if you put cables underneath, free in the space, and I have here a model for a foot walking bridge on the right side. And this type of structures I developed as students, I think it was the year 51 that I did it. This model was done by a student at Washington University, St. Louis, 1958. And I have seen it then done at the World's Fair in Montreal, built in wood, on steel cables, of course, by Canadians. Next picture, please. And with this one, we are coming to pre-stressed membranes. And the most simple pre-stressed membranes, which is warped, double-curved, saddle-shaped, is a four-pointed tent on the right side of the picture. 3 points, it's not possible, then you get the flat plane, and the flat plane likes to move in wind pretty much. It is too light for self-stabilization, and you have to stabilize through pre-stressing. And on the left side, there are umbrellas, and so-called bicycle-like roof. These structures has been firstly erected 1955 on the German Garden Exhibition in Kassel. The next picture. 2 years later, 1957, I had the chance to erect this building spanning 36 meters over the so-called dancing pool in Cologne. It was a job only for one summer, but it happened then that the people liked it so much that it was after this every year re-erected. And only we changed sometimes the membrane. The first membrane had been cotton, wonderful material, pure white cotton. And these are pictures from the original pictures from 57. Now we are repeating the building. I think it's just now repeated. Because to re-erect it, it is now under protection as a monument of architecture. I never wanted to make monuments. I'm an anti-monumentalist, but you can't avoid it. But maybe it was getting as the anti-symbol of the city, because on the other side of the cathedral, there's a cathedral, the huge bridge, and the dancing pool. Next pictures. Also, this building in the same year, 1957, your director has just shown me maybe the latest one of these family of buildings. We call it Hump 10. Just, was it standing here, or? Or there, I don't know, he has shown me a very good hump tent. This one we made very simple. We haven't had time to make this building, I think only 3 weeks to do it. So we have taken a flat canvas without cutting pattern, lay on the ground and push the mast this flexible head from underneath with hydraulic power, and we shaped it like this. And it was standing pretty good. But it is a building on the left side, and as I see it, on the right side. On the right side, it was the first time that I had to work for Queen Elizabeth, because as I, it's the building, yes, it is in Aberdeen. In Aberdeen, I have forgotten the year, it was just the year when the first oil was coming out of the North Sea, going to Aberdeen to the BP plant. And I had the chance to make a party tent for the Queen. It's 40 to 80 meters large as a hump tent out of cotton. So-called Scotch weave, reinforced with some polyester. And I think it worked very good. And later on it was standing in London, here at the Hyde Park for the so-called silver jubilee, and later on it disappeared in Saudi Arabia. I don't know, maybe a sheikh has bought it. And so it disappeared. Next picture. And this building was once also on the Garden Exhibition 1957 in Cologne. And in this building we tried at first a new material. I said we, and the we is especially Mr. Strohmeier, Peter Strohmeier, in this time the world leading tent builder, and we tried here to use glass fiber, the first time in the world. Since this time, glass fiber membrane tents are spread all over the world later on, because with the glass fiber, the lifetime could go on from about 5 years until now to 20 and sometimes maybe now 40 years. This was the first building. But the first building, this glass fibers was not as good as the later ones, so I have had some problems. Structurally, it was also new, spanning 36 meters, with a steel tube only 16 centimeters in diameter. Engineer this time, Fritz Leonhardt, and I think it was quite an advanced building. Later on, I think this is this building on the right side. Kenzo Tange from Japan invited me to deal with him an international competition. Also, Nervin Candela was invited. We did win it with this type of structure. I offered him this type of structure. It was for the so-called Pan-Arabic Games in Kuwait. See, Kuwait wanted to have an Olympic-size sports city. We haven't built it because the Israeli-Arabic war did just break out in this year. It must have been in the year 68. Next picture. It was one of my best projects, was this Olympic city for Kuwait. Then the Swiss exhibition in Lausanne did come. I think it was 63 or 4 on the left side. It was the first time that we did use prefabricated cabinet covered with a membrane. And with the same type of structure we did then the Montreal Pavilion at the World's Fair. I think it was not this one, but this building was then the breakthrough in the whole world for these type of new structures. Because with the prefab cabinet, you could make three hanging spans up to several hundred meters. And to make and to cover floor plans, all which you like. There is no formal limit. Of course, you have to know the structures. Next picture, please. To make the Montreal Pavilion, we made at first a test building. This is a test building we erected in 65. And it is 17 meters high and 32 meters in diameter. It is just done from the original details of the Montreal Pavilion. It was firstly covered with a canvas, later on covered with wood, and it was the time when I was at the University of Stuttgart. It started 64, but the building was done 65, was then my research institute at the university. And we have had many conferences, and international conferences there, but especially interdisciplinary conferences where biologists, engineers, medicine, city planners did participate. Next picture, please. A big building was, then the roof for the Olympic Games in Munich. The engineer was once more Fritz Leonhardt, and the architectural crew was around Behnisch and Partner. The roof was done specially by Fritz Auer. And they are about 80,000 square meters, steel cabinet covered with acrylic glass, plexiglass. Next picture. The left building was for the exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art, just a little sculpture done of my assistants from this time, Larry Medlin. And on the right side, a sports hall, 110 to 80 meters. And done, the engineering was done by Ted Heppert. I think it was in the year, I've forgotten it, 76. Thank you very much for helping me. Next picture. It was a steel cabinet. One of the thinnest structure which I could do, it was an aviary for the zoological garden in Munich, where a young potential architect has done the design with us. And using wire net and being very strong, similar as strong as a long spanning roof, about 100 meter long, 40 meter wide, 20 meter high, so thin that people could go through the bird cage without having the feeling to be in a building. We had to invent a special method to connect the wires. The net is erected on ground, and many trees that stand there and pushed through the trees into the air. Next picture. Large tent out of glass for the and two-way palace, or the diplomatic club in Riyadh. The outside tents are of glass, the inside tents are cabinet, and in the middle of the building is a fountain out of granite stone, and above the granite stone is a shade tent, but the shade tent is out of glass, and the glass is painted, hanging in a pre-stressed tent out of 6 millimeter wires, not wires, of cables, and out of stainless steel with 30 centimeter mesh. Once more, Bureau Heppold as engineer. Next picture. The painted tent, 2,030 panels, painted burnt glass painting, like in old cathedrals, 8 millimeter float glass, with a very little clamp connected to the cables, in a distance to allow air flow through. It is to 90% shade roof above the fountain. It was nearly one work of painting of my daughter Bettina. Next picture. And now I'm coming to a little speciality. the largest pre-stressed cable roofs, and supported by masts and hanging cables, of course pre-stressed. In the year 1961. And I was asked to make a design to cover the harbor in Bremen, because in this time the ships didn't like to load off chocolate and tobacco and to open the ships, so they wanted a cover harbor. They built a new harbor. So we made a design, engineer Fritz Leonhardt, of 550 meters free span and long, 1,800 meters. It would have been in this time the largest cabinet roof in the world, and the mass has been around 100 meters high. We have completely calculated its route and covered with plastic sheets. Much before our design for the Swiss exhibition. Next picture. And only a few details of this building, because this building, of course, has then a certain relation to a very large building here in this city. Next picture. But before it was 65, I get an invitation of the City of London asking me for the new part of social housing planned in Southwark to make a winter building, a building above other buildings which are in production, because in this time I heard the workers were going on strike and they don't like to work in rain and in winter. So I made a proposal in such a type of a grid of 40 to 40 meters high with mass of 40 meters high. So you are getting tubes 40 by 40 meters, which can be free span that even the building cranes underneath can work. And the thing is arranged like this, that it could change if the buildings are ready, you can take it over and grow like a crab over land, and the ready buildings are coming out. The producer was once more Peter Strohmeier with his factory in Konstanz. But it was never built because maybe the workers did not follow their strike. I don't know the interior details here in this city. Next picture. And on the right side, it was a design for Tenerife for the new fair hall. I was unhappy I haven't built it. It's now built by Calatrava. On the left side, I should made a second party tent for Queen Elizabeth about 15 years ago, it was, for Salem Woe. And at Salem Woe was founded a new refinery. Salem Woe is one of the islands in the Shetlands. And there is a refinery for oil, and they once more wanted a party tent exactly like the old one, which I have shown you, 40 to 80 meters, and I offered this one. And there's a mass are going through, only four mass. But they have only the size which are really necessary for this type of structure. Next picture. The newest design, but we have been also unhappy. We have not built it, was for the Berlin Olympic Stadium from 1935, and put it to hang the roof on four masts and making, I think it is the lightest possibility to make, to cover a stadium when you are allowing masts in the corners, which are not much differing with the side views of the people. The best way is to cover now a cable net with a thin, translucent PTFE foil. Next picture. Now I'm coming to another kind of system, movable roofs. At first, the umbrellas. The first umbrellas I did, 1971 for another garden exhibition in Cologne on the right side. 17 meters in span, which are moved and automatically with electric power. In winter they are closed, and in summer when they are needed, they are opened. Another structure which I liked very much is on the left side. They are a row of umbrellas, I think done in the late 70s. I get the job here in London, and these have been three former students of architects, but they think it's better to make music. And I made them for the Pink Floyd. They looked to my design and to the models only 10 minutes, then they said, oh yes, do it, and they're rushing out. The umbrellas are like this, that they are overlapping, and the rainwater is going into the mass. And so you can create a thing, a large area, where the rain is not falling and underneath. Like the old umbrellas like this, they always are getting the rain outside. You are getting the same amount of rain if you connect them as without umbrellas. So they are very good for shading, not so good for rain. So we have had quite a lot of experiences for this type of umbrellas. Next picture. Of course, I have had then a big help with my friends in Stuttgart, Bodo Rasch and Jürgen Bradac. This is also an umbrella. That is the Pavilion of Venezuela last year. It's a World's Fair. The architect is Bruto Vivas, the engineers are once more Bureau Heppold, and the structure is opening and closing on the right side. It is closed like a dome, and then it is driven by hydraulic power to open it. The span is quite a lot. I think nearly 40 meters, and underneath is a three-story pavilion of Venezuela. It was a big, I think it was a very nice building, taking some attraction for this country. Next picture. Once more, smaller umbrellas. This row of umbrellas was, on the left side, was designed in the, I think, 15 or 18 years ago from Bodo Rasch and team with my consultation for the big mosque in Mecca. You see the Kaaba there in the third. And on the right side, they have built for the two courtyards of the mosque in Medina. The Arabians are now very happy because they are closed at night and open only on very hot summer days, but also they closed be closed on rain, which is of course very seldom in Mecca, but they are looking very fine and connected in the, also in the shape and forms of these old huge mosques. The mosque in Medina is very, very large. next picture. This picture should have been one part of slides before. This is the inner life of the pavilion for Venezuela in Hanover from last year. You see the hydraulic equipment in one of the corners. Next picture. Movable larger roofs. We have built quite a lot of them in Germany and in France. One of the first one, built 1969, was for this church ruin in Germany in Bad Hersfeld. And making a roof of 40 to 40 meters, covering nearly 2,000 people for an open-air theater. And when you push a button, next picture, then the roof is coming out on the left side and closing it in 3.5 minutes. We had to develop even special equipment, so-called rope tractors, which are pulling the roof. On the right side, it is a design also from middle of the 60s for a big stadium, which is a convertible stadium, also convertible underneath, so that you could make a real Olympic Games in it, but also football to enlarge the seating areas and to make an inner city building with a hanging roof on the top of a tilted mast. Next picture. You see here for a swimming pool, because in summer it's very warm, the water is getting warm, but if the sun is going somewhat down, there is a certain point where it's good to cover the swimming pool and to have the warm air, and the warm water doesn't cool out, and in winter you can the building heat. It is an ecological and also for an energy saving, a very interesting system developed in these early 60s. Next picture. Now I'm coming to the lightest structures at all. The lightest structures at all, unbeaten, are the air structures. The first air structure invented, and there was a patent from 1917 by an Englishman and an automobile designer, Lanchester. I think he has never seen in his life an air structure. After the war in the United States, Walter Bird and myself in Germany with a little team once more developed these air structures, at the beginning without knowing from Lanchester. So on the right side, it was for a garden pavilion in Rotterdam, 1958. On the left side, a photograph, which is difficult to photograph, of a free-floating soap bubbles. And we made many soap bubble tests. Next pictures, not only for air structures. Also on the left side, with students in Delft in the Netherlands, the students made a foot-walking bridge out of an air tube. You could have it in a little trunk of weighing a few kilograms, I don't know, 15 or something like it. So you can walk over one of the canals in the Netherlands. On the right side, it was for the 300th jubilee of the German Academy of Arts, where I'm the member and my co-members did ask me to help to design a little jubilee ship. And this is this thing. It is illuminated from inside, and music is inside, and projections on the screen. It is just a simple air structure. Next picture. But with air structures, also in the year 1958, I started to study large structures. I'm not for it to make just large structure to be going into the Guinness Book of Records, but sometimes they are necessary. This was a design for a factory using an aluminum skin of 2 millimeter or 2.5 millimeter thickness of, and every dome is 800 meters in diameter. And blowing up, of course, you need permanent pressure, which is, I think, now not the problem. But you can have many, many different type of shapes. Next picture. So our largest structure, which we designed, was this one, the so-called a city in the Arctic. An air structure of 2 kilometer span. We worked together in a Japanese, English and Japanese team. Kenzo Tange made the whole city planning, and the engineering was done at UF Arabs and Partner under the leadership of Ted Heppold. Also Peter Rice, Ian Little worked for it. And so we got the knowledge that it's possible to make a dome over a diameter of 2 kilometers. It covers 0.3.14 square kilometers. But the forces have been not astonishing high. Even you do not need a high interior pressure. Maybe a lower one, a little lower one, as if you are doing smaller structures. It later then happened during the oil crisis that we nearly have had built a similar building for Alberta in Canada. The Canadians wanted us in the oil crisis because they have there a huge plant of oil sands. Maybe they are coming now because we have now a new oil crisis. So, Michael, you have to look at the next picture. But also these things making fun, there was an airshipper asking me to make an airship. So it was called Airfish number 1. On the right side is the Airfish number 3. For an airship which is completely unstiff, even the cabin, only the motor which is not stiff. It is now easier to make an airship which is unstiff as a so-called a stiff zeppelin. And so there may be a new generation of airships coming. Next picture. A complete other type of air structure is an air structure with low inside or negative inside pressure. We made this screen on the left side for the Berlin Industrial Fair, I think it was the 1964 or 5. On the right side, it is, which we also have been nearly built, an air structure which is movable, which is not bound on ground. For a garbage plant, they wanted over the garbage plant an air structure of about 500 meters spanning, which is slowly moving over the garbage plant and the ready garbage plant completely protected as is necessary and planted and so on, and it is coming out. It is like an amoeba moving over the land. You need then a complete other a foundation. The foundation is should be then by the covering earth, so that the cable net it is lay on the ground, and the inside covering is a foil moved in. It is really possible. It may be also the cheapest method to make every an air house or an air structure, because you do not need these ugly and I think completely wrong concrete foundations for air plants. It is really stupid to make the lightest building what you can do and then hang it on very heavy weights. It is just wrong. Next picture. Now I have talked so much on structures, but structures are not houses. Structures are helping to make houses. Something is here wrong with the microphones. Maybe I go a little bit further. And also houses. This project on the left side, it is, we started 1953, I was just made my studying at the end, 220 houses in Berlin, social housing planning. I discovered how difficult it is with the lowest money to make houses. And I show it only because I know now, since last week, it's also a protected building. next picture. And this is a single family house, it's my own one, on a village near Stuttgart, where it is a glass house above just a normal house. So the glass house is helping to protect the normal house, and it's also a green house to live in. Next picture. On the left side, this design is now about 15 years old, with a little competition with the German Flutglas company, it's a sister of Pilkington. But it happened that now I have seen, I think, 5-year design in Riyadh, which looks like similar done from a British architect. But for what I am interested is on the right side. When I was a student, I always think, because I like single family houses, but how to do single family houses in cities which are very condensely built. So I made as students a design to build single family houses out of or on artificial done lots in space. And then on, it was 1980, I got the job from the city of Berlin to make a design for these houses called ecological houses, where the owners are allowed to build their own houses, maybe with their hands on artificial done flat spaces in air. Next pictures. And we have had the opportunity to build some in Berlin together with my friend Hermann Kendall, who worked also in the Montreal Pavilion. And we made only these flat areas in the air in 6-meter heights and in 12-meter heights, and allowed the owners and to build their own houses with their own architects. So we made three objects, and in every objects are four houses in the ground floor, four houses in the middle floor, and one house on top. So there are 9 houses in 3 objects. So we have 27 single family homes built by the owners. So I'm not responsible for the what the owners have done. Of course, I was responsible for the infrastructure, and I had to protect them against some city planners always wanted to change it, because now the city of Berlin is quite strict in forcing special forms of buildings. And for me, it was just an experiment. I wanted to know how much freedom can you give to people. And I think you can give, and you should give, freedom for design, for architects, and allow, like here, a younger architect to make their chances. Single family houses, but built under the social housing program, not more expensive as other social housing, but completely individual. Next picture. On the left side is another view of these three buildings. On the right side, I think only 14 days before my love friend Ted Heppel died, he asked me to build a house or to design a house for him. It should be a so-called non-energy house. I mean, getting his own energy out of the air from sun and wind, and using the system of passive solar power and active solar power, and just a little grid shell, big covered, and also then covered with grass, big insulated. Next picture. Of course, interior design is also a part of houses. On the left side is a chair which I did for the Montreal World Exhibition. On the right side, it was a cooperation between India and the United States, using Indian craftsmanship for some possibilities in the United States, a so-called golden eye. Next picture. And things which are not finished now. The structure on the left side are two tents in Leonberg, Germany, which are highly insulated and have insulating glass for two shops spanning 24 meters. On the right side is a bridge which we will start this year in northern Germany. It is done out of steel members, not tubular steel, but rods of 70 millimeter thickness. The bridge is about somewhat more than 100 meter long, a foot walking bridge, and 3 meters wide. Next picture. Our newest and largest project is for the architect Ingenhofen and for the city of Stuttgart. It is the largest German railroad project, and the new railroad station underneath, a station underneath this old protected building. That's the old railroad station, the tower, going underneath now, just in a right angle to the old railroad. And it was the idea of Ingenhofen to put the railroad underneath, because there's a big park. The station is 450 meters long for the modern trains, around 18 meters wide, but there is only 12 meter height. So it would be a very, very long, thin room and wide. What to do? And And I showed him the method to put at the same way as the light is going underneath, also how the forces are flowing down. Next picture. Using this method, which I have shown you very often, maybe also in my institute, on the left side is a soap bubble test. The first soap bubble test of this one I did 1961, but we repeated it. And this soap bubble test, you can use not only in tension, but also in compression. If you invert the whole thing, then it's in compression. And making a shell also without bending. This is now the actual design of the railroad station in Stuttgart, to getting the forces down. It is a concrete shell, but it's a shell without bending, where it could have been built, or we can then build also in stone, because there's no bending, it is a real vault. But at the same time, as you see, next picture, we are getting the light through. We hope that we can start to build it in about 3 or 4 years. I am very happy that also Bureau Heppelt is going forward with this design, this time joining together with the Bureau Fritz Leonhardt. And so I'm very happy to have one of the best engineers on this object. Of course, the shape is completely done by the architects, but it is a shape which could be easily calculated. When you know exactly the shape, then the calculation always leads to a solution. Next picture. Also, these are underway. A very, very simple building, which is Shigeru Ban, you know, the architect of the paper pavilion in Hannover, wants to do in Iwakuni, a little town in Japan, where a huge wooden bridge is. A very simple hanging roof. Next picture. And even the question how you can make sculptures with these methods is still a thing, so I'm still working in this field. Next picture. I had written a new book on path systems, old street systems, and this book is until the publisher wants it all day to come out, but we are still working on, and also to compare those paths which are animals doing on the left side, or which non-living nature, like crystals on the right side, are doing, to compare them also with paths, so-called natural paths, which are doing man before they started to design streets and paths. And these undesigned old human streets and footpaths are in most cases more energy-wise and correct and then the so-called design patterns of cities and connection of houses. So we hope that next year we could force this book on the market. Next picture. And there's another way on which we are working since many, many years in my institute with hundreds of experiments of students, are the so-called bridges, stone bridges. How stable are they in earthquake? Of course, also to study the so-called natural bridges on the right side, not done by man. And what is the shape of those bridges which is earthquake stiff? It's on a test on the left side. and has the smallest amount of stone. Next picture. Also, these two designs of bridges are coming out. They are really also, the models are done by cut in pieces and tested it. A bridge on the left side, which makes an S shape, and you can really build it in stone, just put together without any steel in. On the right side, it is a bridge which makes a 200 degree circuit. Next picture. And about since 1960, I have had a special research grant of the German government, but later on, we worked on natural structures, on structures which are, which you see in nature. On the left side, it is an intestine of a pig. On the right side, it is a stiff, it is a shell. On the left side, it is soft. On the right side, it is out of natural glass. It is a diatomite. And we discovered that all structures in living nature are in exact spoken a pneumatic structure, but filled with water, even if they are later on stiffened, and that they are very light, and that all structure in living nature are done with only one structural element. It is a closed hull, reinforced by fibers and with inside pressure. And that this structure are unbeaten in the realization and using energy. We did this work not to imitate natural structure. In reality, this is impossible. But we wanted with biologists, medicines, mathematicians, building engineers, and architects to make a study and to know more about non-living nature and living nature. But this work is not finished. I have to do a lot of work now by myself, because when you are a pension professor, you have no team anymore, and you are really alone. But the work has to be done. So I'm very strong working, and especially in the field of natural structure. Once more, not to use them for architecture, just for learning to know what nature is. And this work also is the link between the plan of nature. The plan is a genetic code, and the reality. The reality is out of fibers and water and something else. Could I have now light? Could you take the pictures out just for a last little word? I hope that it was not too much for you to shoot you through 5 decades work, which is really done. I started my work in 46, but very strongly. I'm a free working architect since 52. So this is nearly, a half century of work, a half century out of research, it's a half century out of sculpturing forms, and a half century of natural sciences, hoping to know a little bit more about nature and what is nature doing, how the shapes of nature are coming into reality. So I will say thank you very much for you to listen to this lecture. And if you have any question, please hesitate. Please don't hesitate to ask them. Don't hesitate to ask them. Thank you very much.
I think it's such a sort of bewildering, amazing kind of selection. Yes, please, Richard,
can
yes.
Can I come there? Because
we can also give you a microphone. Yeah.
Oh, right. It was
this is the famous Richard Burton.
Hello, Richard.
This isn't a question, this is a eulogy. Tonight we've heard from a man who is one of the true originals of architecture. It's been a great, great privilege. It's been an enormous privilege to have worked with Frei, enormous privilege. And the thing that comes out of it for me, and I hope you will appreciate that, it's difficult, he's in such a short time, given us five decades, is the incredible study that this man does when he looks at any problem. And I've experienced that, and a number of us who've worked with him know this extraordinary application and originality of thinking. And as architects, he's a great model maker. I mean, everything is studied with models, and I think we learn something from that. We learn the physicality of the whole situation. And the other thing I've learned is the ability that he has for actually working with people, which, you know, he mentions always the people he's worked with. I mean, who does? You know, it's just wonderful to be part of that team. And Frei, I would just simply say thank you tonight for a great, great occasion. And I'm sure all of us would like to join with me in thanking you yet again for this great originality and the work.
Was not the answer.
I know this
once
is
once more. This can be not an answer. Was not a question. But
I know.
Thank you very much. I had the opportunity to work with you, and that we could do little things here in this country. It's wonderful.
Thank you. Maybe I will start with one brief question, which has to do with the beginning, very beginning of the lecture, when you mentioned also your training. As a mason in some way, working with heavier materials. And then, almost like the second slide, we went very quickly into the lightweight structures. And I think it would be wonderful if you could say exactly how you made this shift from working with heavy materials, and you thought that it would be really important also to work with lightweight structures.
Yeah, but I think it's just relation to my biographical background, because as school people or school pupil, I was working as a stonemason, but just training. My father was a sculptor, my grandfather too. This was quite clear. Mm-hmm. The other foot what I has had is to build a gliding planes. And then in the war, I had to serve as pilot. I was never in the air war, but a full-trained pilot. And I even, in this time, I had the chance to design planes, motor planes too. And so at the end of the war, I was a pilot and a plane designer, coming with 19 in prisoner of worship, or was before, between 17 and 18. Mm-hmm. And then in prisoner of worship, and we have had a camp of 40,000 people, and in the year 45, many of the prisoners died, and there was necessary to build a cemetery. And of course, like German art, the prisoners started an architectural competition to design the cemetery. And being one of the 40,000 prisoners, I said, no, I take a little piece of paper which I found and started to make a sketch design for the cemetery. But this sketch design, I don't know why, but then I was choosing to come in the team to build the cemetery. And then a half a year later, I was the leader of the team. And while I was responsible, because the leader of the team could go home, and I was responsible for about 200 German, very good craftsmen, masters of all different kinds, and we had the leading people in this prisoner of war camp. And so I had to serve as architect without one semester training at school. But my training was at one time to make gliders and to think about architecture. I have had very good architects in my team. I was only responsible because I was the youngest, and it was quite sad. I have to be at least 2 years in prison of worship. So I did come then at the end of 47 home. And so I have had different kind of background. Lightweight building from the air, heavy building from stone, mixing it together. And then as chief architect and engineer of this camp, I had no material. How to build with no material? And so the idea was coming, and I wrote in this time a scientific paper, how to build to make structures mostly out of steel, old rails which are laying around, to build with the lowest amount of material. I did not know that this paper was a real origin paper. Later on, I studied in Berlin at the Technical University in Berlin, and when I had to do student task, I used my own theory, and then my professor said, it's a new theory, you have to teach it to us. And so all time I was in a wonderful position. I did always my life those things which I really had to invent by myself. So I know them, really. Not learning, but self-inventing, it's always the best way. So I feel me even in architecture until today, like an autodidact. Mm-hmm. And I think autodidacts are very, very important for our profession. So I'm an autodidact, not a professional.
Hopefully we have a few of them here tonight. Irene, you were going to ask something, or have
I was
you?
Going to ask the same question as you, but
sorry. Can you take the microphone, please?
There was something else also I was going to ask, which is that you outlined a very unusual area between architecture and engineering, and which is not a profession. I guess it's prior to, I suppose. And I wonder whether you could say something about the place of technique in your work, and how does one actually find it out, and perhaps also for the students here, how one learns it. So this is not something which is in books together with equations and so on, and with mathematics, etc., or is that something to do with architecture models, or maybe sculpture, even as Richard Burton was mentioning. So something about the status of technique in construction.
I do not know if I have understood your keyword. There was one keyword which I have just not understood in your question.
And the keyword is technique.
Keyword is
technique. What is the status of technique in terms of the development of your work?
Yeah, I was going in other way as most of the engineers. That was also the reason that Fritz Leonhardt wanted me on the University of Stuttgart to teach this other way of thinking, which is in reality the old way of stonemasons and woodworkers to bring things together, study them in reality without any complicated equations. I know only two or three, four equations which are necessary and even can, of course, dimension buildings. But I am going another way. And this way leads also to other forms. Of course, sometimes I accuse my friends, the engineers, that they are unscientific, because it's very difficult to be really scientific as engineer, because a normal physician, when he has a theoretical model, he must prove it with an experiment. When building engineer has a theoretical model, he cannot prove it before he has built his building. And even most of the building, like a concrete or stone buildings, are very difficult to prove. To know that the forces and stresses which you have calculated are really in. And I was going the other way, to invent with modeling, even proofing. I have said in the 50s very often to my friends, if you can't calculate it, I build. And I show that this is true, because you can go this other way. So, and this was a very, until now, it's a good link. There's only one problem, that many of engineers are not doing any more these models. So it happens, yeah, these are these,
do something about these.
Yeah, they are 2 years together or something like it. It happened that some years, I think 3 or 5 years, an Ulf Arup asked me to build up his model shop. Later on, then I did it for the University of Bath, and so we put all these knowledge together. And also when at Tepple did build up the school of building in Bath, he used as model our old Stuttgart school. And I think in such a way that is it possible. But quite interesting, after we introduced, and I helped also 1965 to introduce the computer calculation into building, it's the Montreal Pavilion, it was the first building which we did with computer control. But then it has been nearly 20 years where model work was done by engineer. Oh, so much work we are not doing. We have here the computer and getting the result. The problem was, who is controlling the computer? Because there are many, many possibilities. Sometimes you have infinite possibilities to shape a building, how you are controlling. Now, once more, the good teams of engineers restarting to make models. And one thing is true, when you as craftsman has done a model with your own hands, you know the building, because with your hands you are always over. If you look only to a screen, Have you then understood the building? This is a real problem. Both professions, the architect and the engineers, must come together. The engineer should be still more scientific to control their buildings before they are building them. That is very much necessary. So it needs a higher working really in a natural scientific way in engineering. And especially if you want to understanding non-living nature, but especially living nature, you have to go this way of theoretical and of the real experimenting. There is no way around.
I'm interested in the link with that you have with Saudi Arabia and Kuwait, and how you actually came to work there, and whether there's you have a sort of a definite link to Islamic patterns in your architecture, or whether it's because your architecture was seen by people in the Islamic world to be interesting to them.
But what's the question?
The question is, do you, the fact that you're working in Kuwait and in Saudi Arabia, is it because of the fact that you have a special interest in Islamic geometry, or is it that the Arabs have seen in your work something that they feel is close to them? Is that sort of?
I don't know, because I was coming to Saudi Arabia because I was invited for the first time for an invited competition. The competition was among 7 architects from different countries. From Great Britain was Trevor Dunnett on. And the competition was for Riyadh Conference Center. And we both, Trevor Dunnett and ourselves, we did win. And then King Faisal decided, oh, I like your building. I could think it's good for Mecca. And so we had to build it in Mecca, even if we are not have been no Muslims.
So it's the other way around. The Arabs thought that it's good. Good. Florian, yeah. Can you take the microphone, please?
I want
please?
To come back to Irene's question. I think one of the most important words that Frei Otto has used is form finding. He says form finding and shape finding, and he doesn't say designing. And this maybe is that's a different, it's something about finding what is there, and it's not something about giving or deciding how it should be.
And what should it, why should it be?
And then maybe you want to say something about that.
Of course, I used the word form finding, not the English word. We have in Germany, please pardon me, a better word, this is Gestalt. Gestalt is a total of a form, not the visual form alone, but the total, which makes a building, which means a sculpture, which makes any design thing. And the other question is how you are coming to the Gestalt, to the form. And there are many ways to do it. One way is also to study things which are themselves making, which are all objects not belonging to arts, which are having the ability to make themselves. But if men, maybe we as architects, are helping objects to make themselves, then automatically we are using self-finding method, but also designing them because we have to select out of all self-making projects. Look, any water engineer will be stupid to make a channel which he is carving in and to making the side one more steep as they are natural. Then it costs big money to make a vertical wall in earth. It is, and so it's much cheaper to make it correctly in the so-called natural slope. But to make a channel with a good natural slope, it is a design job too. It is using the self-form finding methods. It's one of the simplest ones which I have just but also making and being responsible for design. So for me, there is a big connection between artifacts and self, natural self-made objects.
In that sense, it's not that dissimilar to some of the Islamic things. But anyway, sorry, you were back there. Can you?
I was wondering if you ever find yourself at great odds with conventional building practices, and if you've ever, if you could talk a little about, bit about your outlook on the way that most structures are.
The question is whether you can say something about what your attitude is, what you feel about conventional practice, because what is happening, what is the everyday, the normal, and the fact that you're doing something that in many respects is so different from the kind of conventional or normal practices. So what are your thoughts about the majority of everyday conventional practices?
I always wanted in my life to do conventional things, because I had the feeling they are necessary, that engineers and architects are working together. And I was always standing on the architect side, not on the engineer side. And so I didn't have any problem on it. Because maybe I have shown you I have done building bridges, normal houses, and nearly the whole line of architects through. So I'm very happy that I have the chance to do it. And also I have not done many, many buildings. I think I have now 13 or 14 buildings in the world standing, not more. I have done very less, and most of my pictures are only models. Photographed so that they look like ready buildings. It was most of my work to stimulate architects to work, yeah? To be a stimulator. Of course, I am also a real inventor, but to stimulate. So in most cases, I'm very happy if my structures or designs are imitated, but only when they are good. If they are bad, then I have some problems.
But I think the question also partly was touching on the fact that even though sometimes you don't specify, in a sense, a kind of ideological reason for some of the buildings, there are suggestions of a different attitude towards the kind of world that is possible within some of the buildings. Let's say when you gave us the example of the shell for making construction without rain, or the idea of covering 2.5 kilometers, it also suggests a different set of social forces, a different kind of probably world. And
but
so
there may be another point which may interest you, because I never followed those movements or fashions in architecture. Right. I started and I was going straight through, always asking what's necessary, what's not necessary to make buildings with the lowest amount of energy, which on the long run is always lowest amount of money, quite at first energy. Sometimes new buildings with lower energy you have at the beginning to pay more, later on they are getting cheap. I was just not interested about all these movements of the brutalism, postmodernism, and deconstructivism, and all these things. It has just not interested me. And I think it would be very good also for young people not to follow this line of fashions, because now we are in a very happy situation. All these fashions, the last one was, I think, the deconstructivism, complete nonsense. Now, by the word, because a building needs some structures. How you can build without structures? The lightest one is the air structure, to build with air, but it's not easy to build with air. It is a cheap building material, but you have to know about it, and the most are making mistakes there. But it is a nonsense to follow these things, and we are in this very happy decade now. You are, because I'm at the end of my career, you are at the beginning of your career. Don't follow the fashions, just do what you have to do. For your profession, for your clients. Do what you have to do. Now, no fashion is a leading one. It's very good. And don't start to make a new one. But, I can offer you some names for it. But they are great things. But do what you have to do.
Well, I think the great thing was when you started talking about learning from natural structures, and you said that you're doing that in order to understand something, not to actually imitate those things.
Yes.
And I think it very much is related to what you're saying now in relation to architecture's connection, let's say, to philosophy and whatever, that often it's done in the name of imitation, right? And I mean, maybe to defend deconstruction, maybe there are things that architects could have learned, but it's just that we ended up doing things that probably looked more like the word rather than something that was really the exploration of a phenomenon or a certain set of ideas. And that,
When I said do what you have to do, I mean, if you want to know what's going on in the future, in this new century, which is your century, not more mine, then it's very clear what to do to solve the unsolved questions. And what is unsolved in architecture? Shall we start with catastrophe building? How you can avoid that an earthquake is killing 100,000 people? Look, I was working as visiting professor in the city of Ahmedabad in Gujarat, India, where the famous National Institute of Design is on. I'm very happy I helped some buildings there and they were not killed by the last earthquake. But 100,000 people, even maybe more, have been killed in a few minutes there. It is a solved question or not? It is not a solved question. We know how to build buildings. And still, when I was working there, the Indians were looking so strong to German social housing, and they introduced the laws of German social housing, because they have such high view of Germany. But it was completely wrong. I told them, it is wrong, it's culturally wrong, it's structurally wrong. You have to find your own way. And you have to find your own way. It's very happy that England has not this big impact, but do you know earthquakes are coming for 10,000 years and more? Nobody really knows. And what is with these other catastrophes? Well, it's only one part. And what are you really doing you should think about it. And so it's quite easy to sign and to bring those questions for the future. Where good questions are, you have good answers. And you should ask those questions. Where are the open, unsolved areas? The last ones are the formal ones. How design a window or like it? That's the last question. Also important. I'm not saying that's unimportant. It's important, very too. But the basic question for humanity, and even that all kinds of plants, animals, and men are coming together, that even your senses are correct, that you know what a sensibility architecture will be if you are an architect. This is a way into the future. So it's very easy to make, like a weather forecast, an architectural forecast. You have only to ask for the unsolved things.
Thank you. I'm sure that we could sit here for another 2 hours and it would be wonderful. I want to thank you for speaking with such precision and such passion. Thanks very much, Frei Otto. Thank you.